Good morning. That was quite the introduction. I wish my mother was still alive, but for that. Great. I'll try to modestly live up to that. So I think, and look, the Apollo 13 thing, by the way, that was a great metaphor. I'm going to probably attribute it to you and use it in the future. I thought that was so great. So we're going to talk about implementation science, and one of the things that we always like to do is to, as you know, to go fast, you go alone, to go far, you go with others. We have many people to thank for this journey, teams and teams of people, when you're developing a new science, a new discipline. It's messy and you need lots of people to participate with you. We're looking at implementation science as a bridge between best evidence and improved outcomes. There, we now know that we're going to blow out that rectangle square that Trina had up where it says implementation science. We're going to blow that out and see what's inside it and how do we build this bridge. So what is implementation science? Brief definition, it's the study of variables and conditions that impact changes at the practice, organization, and systems level. And those are changes that must be done to promote more systematic uptake, sustainability, and effective use of evidence-based programs and practices in typical human service settings, which is a connection to the Apollo 13. And we don't have the resources that go into a randomized controlled trial or a big IES grant when we're doing our work in the field. We have what we have in terms of resources, but we need to have that systems change. And I'm going to tell you some ways in which I'll bring you some bad and sad news, and some ways in which we'll bring you some hopeful and some good news. Everybody here fine? Yeah? Okay. Great. Trina's already done this part, so I'm not going to stay long on it, except to say we're grateful for our home at Frankfurt Grand. We're grateful for Florida Mental Health Institute at the University of South Florida for taking a wild flyer with us and saying, how about we call the National Implementation Research Network into being? Let's just name it and make it so. And now it's about a global network of people who are interested in implementation science. So the way we learn about it is we ask people, you know, there's craft knowledge. We needed to ask people who were implementing evidence-based practices. We needed to ask the program developers and researchers how they did it. We interviewed 64 program developers to say, what's important when people are trying to implement your what? And we do the work in the real world, hence the little guy with a scraped up knee. This is absolutely, despite my 40 years in the field, 40 plus years, this is the hardest work I've ever done. Maybe it's just because I'm getting old, so if you are younger, it'll be okay. So we are trying to, because we're putting this in systems that already have a life of their own, and I'll shed some more light on that. So one way in which I'm going to disturb you a bit is to say, this can't be the work of practitioners. We cannot ask individual practitioners, individual teachers, individual rehab specialists, individual social workers to do this on their own. Not fair, not feasible. So we'll talk about some of those systemic issues that are important. And we use the literature. We're continually scanning the literature. When we get, this is a, there's a free download, but this is really slow to download. I'm sorry that you'll get it. And when we did this back in, published in 2005, and we're working on the update now, we reviewed about 785 articles that had any kind of data about implementation in a qualitative case study, quasi-experimental. And we kept our search terms out there and have people now looking for us. And we now have an EndNotes database, for those of you that are a little geeky, about 3,400 articles related to implementation science. The field has just exploded. So what is our team learning that we can share with you that might be interesting? Well, so Trina said in preparing for this conference that people are here from different domains, right? Educators, rehab, not sure who all else, but so you don't all share a common domain necessarily. So one of the things that we did learn by, because we read across domains, we learned that there are striking commonalities. We took one little narrative and blanked out what the it was and had people try to put it in. What is the it that people are talking about?
Nobody guessed it because it was weed control. But they could put their issues into that same paragraph and find common ground with people doing weed control, hotel management, cancer prevention through application of sunscreen, educational practices. So the implementation issues are common across diverse domains. Hey guys, and you know what else? While I'm thinking about it, everybody wants us to be, well, not everybody, that's a bad word. There's lots of chatter about we should be more business-like. We should be more like business. I gotta tell you, business is no better than any of us are when there is a human-to-human interaction. So total quality management, getting that in place with fidelity, a bust. Now, business has an edge over us, right? Because once the product is the solution. So if I make a pair of pliers and want to get that used in garages all over the world, once I have the pliers made, really, they show up in the toolbox every day. They aren't hungry. They haven't threatened suicide in the last few hours. They aren't getting evicted from their home. There's a me to an atom-based thing versus this interaction-based world that we live in, where all these mutual influences are occurring. So don't let them pull that on you. Business is no better, maybe worse in many cases, than we are in getting the work done. But the solutions do seem common. And so there's hope for all of us that when we look across domains, we can learn across them and apply them to our own work. So what are we learning? So across disciplines, when we, and we haven't yet found things to refute any of this yet, in the we're always looking for, as scientists, we're always looking to disprove. Where's the hole? So what we found is that these methods, when used alone, are insufficient. This was heartbreaking for me. I love training. I love performing. I love doing this. And so to find out that training alone is ineffective for implementation was heartbreaking. Okay, so what are we gonna do? You know, one and done, sit and get, not gonna work, you know, spray and pray, whatever we call it, it's not gonna work. Passing laws and mandates alone, providing funding and incentives, organizational change, reorganization. Now a little, is what we found is that you get about a 5 to 15% uptake when you're really relying on one of these. So you don't get zero. But you say, is that enough of a return on investment to invest in this? I don't think so. Now, the good news that gave me hope and a better value for myself so I could stop grieving was that these are necessary components. They're just not sufficient. People can't be excited and interested in doing an evidence-based practice that they don't know anything about. So it's just some common sense that says that these are important parts, important pieces of the puzzle, but you aren't going to make the whole picture with them, right? Makes sense? So, you know, I think as Trina said, you know, we do know a lot now, but what we're doing is not working very well, that we don't always use the best research, especially when our legislatures get involved and, you know, their cousin Susie used magic eight ball reading programs and they now think everybody should use that because she really likes them. Implementation gap, when we do pick something that has good evidence, we have a hard time using that innovation with fidelity. Just quick, because I don't know you guys, how many of you, if I say the word fidelity, you could give me like a little elevator speech about it? Raise your hand. Okay, good. So we have a problem doing it as intended, the way it works. We have difficulty building the capacity to sustain the innovation. So Stephen Luce said, you know, we've lit 1,000 pilot lights, and we have yet to build a central heating system. So we have all these demonstration projects, coming and going and coming and going, and we don't seem to be able to sustain, grow, and develop, with a few notable exceptions. And so scaling, and we have difficulty scaling up innovations to provide access and benefits to citizens and society. So what we have now, I call the Lucky Charm cereal approach. If your kid or your family or your brother, sister are lucky and land someplace where a practitioner is using best evidence, good. But we have to move beyond the lucky few. It is not fair. And anyway, later. So what is the way forward through this very challenging work that needs to be done? Kind of looks like parts of Arizona, although I have been shown the mountains and the trees and know that there's more to Arizona besides the desert. So let's shift the focus. I'm going to ask you to shift your brains from what works to improve mental health, what works to improve social-emotional development, what works to improve academic outcomes, what works to improve someone's physical health. So still need that good what. But now let's think about what we need to do to improve the practices of well-intentioned professionals, teachers, service providers. How do we change their behavior? For those of you that are researchers, how do we create the independent variable? What are the organizational structures and functions to support the practices? These practices can't live in a vacuum and they can't live in a hostile environment. How do we change the environment to support it? And the big challenge, how do we get more implementation-informed decision-making made by funders and policymakers? Well, I'm sure you all have stories about the things the legislature thinks you should do magically with two short time frames and no additional resources. Like, here, lob it out there, take care of it. So, and why do we want to shift the focus? Because no matter how much we know, children, individuals, and families cannot benefit from interventions and supports and services that they don't receive. So what we do is we end up with a lot of paper implementation where people say they're doing something, and gee, we now, even with our computers, have search and replace. So we can just take out the last thing we were doing and search and replace and put in the new thing, and we have policies, procedures, lots of paper with things there, but when we walk into the service setting, there's not much change going on there. So we need a paradigm shift. And we want to shift our work from letting it happen, which is what happens through diffusion and networking and communication. We're doing some good letting it happen work here. I prefer to think of it as readiness for you to learn more about implementation science. But, you know, there will be some uptake. You all know those people that are the 5%ers. They can read something and go like, oh, 15 ways to do that. I'm going to go do it tomorrow. They do it. They're great. We admire them. You know, and then there's the rest of us who are kind of mere mortals. And we're going like, wow, that was good. But I have no clue how to get from point A to point B. Helping it happen, we get a little more specificity. We get some manuals, we get some ways of work, we get some websites that are really, can be pretty helpful to us. And then we shift to what we call active implementation, making it happen. Not as in, I will make you do something, because I gave that up after I had children. But purposeful and proactive use of implementation science and best practices so that we stand a fighting chance of getting those best practices to come to life in typical service settings. So let's think about it in terms of a formula for success. It's a simple little formula. First, we need effective and usable interventions, and I'll dwell a little bit on the usable. Multiplied times effective implementation methods, ways to get it in place, times, an enabling context, an environment, a host environment that supports the work, so that we get socially significant outcomes. Outcomes that make a difference in the lives of kids and families. That's sometimes different than statistically significant outcomes, right? So if you aren't educated about something called effect size, go on the internet, learn about effect size, and use it when you're choosing things to do. So why a multiplication? So I have a math phobia. Some of you do not. So any number times zero is what? Zero, right? So if any of these areas are zero, it's a metaphor, it's an analogy, it's not a scientific formula. But in general, one of these boxes or two of these boxes is not enough. You need all three of them there to get socially significant results. And so we're going to do that with a quick tour of active implementation frameworks. We've got a great website. You can learn all about it. This is going to be like a 30,000 foot flyover. So one of the things that we want to have are effective and usable interventions. That wasn't part of our original monograph, but we got here pretty quickly because it turns out people wanted us to help them implement things that were pretty vague. Oh, co-teaching, we want you to help us implement co-teaching. All right, great. Tell me about the core components of co-teaching. Well, you know, how do you know when good co-teaching is going on? Well, there's really a good vibe in the room. There's a lot of flow. Like, I'm not smart enough to help you. You'll have to find other people. So we not only need something that's effective, but we need to know what the core components are, and we need to be able to operationalize those core components. We'll dwell on these a little bit more. Stages. So we do not grow fully grown from the head of Zeus. This isn't how this works. Things go in stages, and so we need to do the right work at the right stage. Too often we're way ahead of the people that need to come with us, and we're operating in one stage where we think we should all be. Other people haven't come along. I'm going to give you a quick analogy now just because I'm thinking about it. It's about my husband, who I adore. So I live with a man happily for 35 years who does a lot of processing in his head before he makes a decision, right? He's thought out all the angles, blah, blah, blah. And then he springs it on me. And I have some questions about that. And he used to say, until I punished him for it, he used to say, well, you're not being very supportive. I'm saying, hey, give me a minute, buddy. You know, you've been thinking about this for 3 weeks in great detail. I need to be brought along on this journey that you've taken to help get me there. So stages are important. Implementation drivers, I'm in love with the implementation drivers. I'm going to marry them, except I'm already married. So we need an infrastructure. We need supports for this uptake. This is the reason, the drivers are the reason why practitioners can't do it by themselves. The rare practitioner can do it by themselves. And to go far, we go together. So we have to have teams. You can have turnover and still keep the work going. We are a country of champions and superheroes. We love them, you know? And champions and superheroes go on their way to their next superhero thing, and the project is left in the dust because that champion is gone. So we need teams. We need to know who's taking responsibility for guiding this sucker to the end of the road so that it works. And we need to do it in a thoughtful way using data. We need to use plan, do, study, act, plan, do, study, check. Y'all have heard that. That's kind of in our society. Mostly we do in this country plan, do, plan, do, plan, do. And we get doo-doo. So we really need to plan, to do, to collect some data, to study our results, to improve and go again. And that's the way that we're going to create more hospitable environments. The other thing we need to do is we need to use data about these processes. Not all ways of doing training are effective ways of doing training. Not all ways of coaching are effective ways of coaching. We always say, you don't actually have training, you didn't do any training, unless you have some kind of pre-post measure of what people got or gained. Otherwise, we got an orientation, we got an interesting thing, but we're not gonna much improve from that. So do we have some kind of a pre-post measure, even a retrospective self-analysis? Anyway, too many weeds, back up on the balcony. And I lost my... Okay. I don't know what happened. I didn't do anything, I swear. And I'm gonna keep talking because I'm gonna get my slides out of my handout thing. I don't know. I did not set this up, so I don't really know. But would you like to come look and see if it's plugged in? Yeah, maybe it's something simple like that. Did we lose power? Maybe they just don't have us on power. Okay, I'm going to keep going, and I will. If there's something you should know, I'll draw it with my fingers and kind of see that. Yeah, let me get out of the way, and maybe I'll move this water so we don't exacerbate the problem. So, you have that formula for success in your brain. We're going back to, I feel like it's a festival up here. So, go back in your brain to that formula for success. The first box was what? An effective and usable intervention, right?
Sorry, Carrie.
No worries.
You do the best you can.
I always do the best I can. I was in 4-H. Our motto, to make the best better. So what is, I think you understand effectiveness and evidence based, and what does the research say? We're not going there. We're gonna dwell on the usable part of this. That's almost too loud. Thank you. All right. So four components, the four things to pay attention to when you have a usable intervention. Do we have a clear description of the program? Do we know, and this is where Trina's chart comes in about client values, practitioner judgment. Are we clear about the philosophy, values, and principles of the intervention? Do we know who it is for? Who stands to benefit? What are inclusion and exclusion criteria? Too often I have seen people say, oh, we're gonna do this with our five-year-olds, and where did it come from? Well, this was a teen program. No. So, clear definition of the program. Second one, clear essential functions or core components. Do we know what the big building blocks are in this program that must be there in order to create change? The reason that's important is if you're gonna do adaptations, by the way, I'm on the anti-adaptation end of things, which if I get my computer back, I'll show you why. To start with, let's first do it as intended, with maybe some modest adaptations to form and setting and culture and language. But if we know the core components, we know what not to adapt out, right? Something's hard. Oh, I know, let's adapt that. That's really hard, we'll just adapt that. And then we need an operational definition of essential functions. What are people saying and doing? What does it look like when people are saying and doing the practice? People have a very hard time here. I will tell you that medical people and special educators are the best at this. Being able to operationalize things and say, what are the behaviors that teachers, paraprofessionals, staff are using to make that core component come to life? And then we need a practical fidelity assessment that can be done in the real world. And over time, we'd like that to correlate with outcomes. Very few innovations come with a well-developed fidelity assessment. But you better have some idea about whether or not it's being done as intended. Because, people, I don't have a fidelity assessment. It doesn't go well. I have no clue how to be helpful. Why didn't it go well? My answer would be, I don't know, and neither do you. But it leads to picking the next ornament for the tree. Like, oh, well, that doesn't work. We'll pick another one. Actually, you never did it. If I have a fidelity assessment, then I know, do I need to improve the way it's being implemented, or did I pick wrong? Without it, we get to random acts of replacement. And it takes up huge amounts of time and energy, and it results in a group of people who are jaded and cynical. This too shall pass, because it has passed before. I don't really gotta jump into the pool. I just wait it out. Yes. Oh, we're back.
Where are we?
We're not there. We're too far. Too far. That's it. Great work. Good job. Woohoo! All right, what is it? When we looked at the data on how well the ITs are described in the literature, looks like about 18% of outcome studies had some measure of the IT, measure of the independent variable. So, and about 7% of those linked essential components to outcomes to say, we think these things help us produce the results. So the IT is not always very clear. Now, some of that is because of journal space, right? You had limitations what you can do. Other things, or when they do it, you go like, oh, that's not gonna work in the real world. That's, you know, I got Apollo 13 and you got a space station. So there's one study, and I live in fear and dread that the people will be in the room, I hope not ever, because I admired the research. What they did was they actually described in quite a bit of detail what went into helping the teacher produce those results. And one of the things that went into that was that every night, for every teacher in the study, a graduate student came to the class, picked up all the materials and papers, did the database processing that needed to be done, and presented them with the materials they needed for the next day. Does that not sound like your environment? Don't you all have, in your schools and classrooms, an individual graduate student dedicated to the, no, I don't think so. So, we need to know what it is. What does this mean for us? Okay, that's not gonna work. Because that's not plugged, we're gonna go this way. Okay, what does this mean for building capacity of communities, agencies, funders to kind of co-create and work collaboratively? Well, we do need to, as Trina said, we need to choose wisely. For gosh sakes, let's pick something that's got a chance in hell of working. Let's identify and operationalize the fuzzy components. Let's get clear. Let's match our expectations, speed and outcomes with the level of readiness of the intervention for the real world use. So, what does that mean? That's a lot of words. That means, if you're the first person to use this out of from the journal into the real world, if you're the first space mission, it will not go well. And there's gonna be a lot more that's gonna have to go into it that you're gonna discover implementing in the real world. Or are you doing school-wide positive behavior interventions and supports? You're gonna have a lot more supports under you, a lot more experience under you to get the work done. And we have to assess and require resources. Can we get the resources we need? And can we support fidelity or some kind of adherence measure? And we'll go into this in more detail this afternoon. Nope, I don't have, this isn't working, I've gotta set it down. All right, so let's look at the middle part of the formula. How and who does the work of effective implementation? We know it occurs in stages, we know we need the implementation drivers, and we gotta have teams to do the work. 30,000 foot flyover, stages, ready, set, go. So you have exploration, the most underused stage. Usually some small group of people has decided something for you, either at the federal level because there's an RFA, or the state level because there's some legislature, or a small management team that has made some kind of decision, and we don't do exploration and buy-in. I'm seeing lots of head nods and laughter, so I figure that's probably true. Then, after exploration, we need installation. Also very neglected, you have to get ready to do this work. You know, there's going to be, how do we select people, and where do they get trained, and what's our coaching agenda, and how do we do our fidelity? We got to have that. And then we're going to do initial implementation. The motto for that is, anything worth doing is worth doing poorly. It won't go well. But you're going to learn a lot and make the changes that you need to make. And full implementation for us, we had to make a operational definition of it. It's when 50% of the practitioners, whoever they are operating at fidelity. People say, oh, it's low. I said, that's high. Because you got new people coming in all the time. You don't have this, you know, I'm going to work at this for the next 15 years and get really good at it. That's unusual. So if you can get 50% of your practitioners up to fidelity, you're in great shape. Now, this next little thing is for all of you as you begin to educate your administrators, yourself, your funders, your legislators. People say, I don't like that 2 to 4 year timeline. I don't like that recommendation. Is it tough? It's not a recommendation. This is actually what it takes to get something implemented and through stages, and that's when you're starting with a pretty well-defined it. And we have legislators that are trying to get reelected and make their mark, and we are short-term thinkers. We need 10-year, 5, 10, 15-year investments in things that work. So what does this mean, stages? We need to engage in stage-based planning and activities. So what is the time frame? What are the goals? It doesn't mean we don't collect data. We collect data all along the way. We have stage-based data to tell people we're 70% through exploration and we've done 10% of the installation stages. And don't skip any. You don't get to skip any because you will get dragged back to what you've missed. And you are always in exploration buy-in. You got new families coming, you got new kids coming, you got new clients coming, you have new administrators coming. You're always working on buy-in. Implementation drivers, that's the second thing under that middle box. We want to build people's competency, we want to improve the organization, and we want to have better leadership, and we want all of those things to be data-based. And they're all pointing up to fidelity. So they're not there for sort of random things of interest. So we're not going to count training that involves team building and we stand in a circle and throw a ball of yarn to each other and say what we like about each other. No, that doesn't count. I think that's good fun, it's good team building, good spirit building, it's a lovely get to know you, bonding thing. It isn't going to get us fidelity. I actually did that project, that activity, so I can talk about it that way. And let me see, go back maybe. It's not going to help me go back. All right. So it's aimed at fidelity. We want to improve the system that we're working in. So we have organizational drivers, so we have data systems that work. We have facilitative administration, we have systems intervention, and we have leadership that works well. And we're hell-bent on some kind of fidelity and adherence measure because, again, you know, I don't know people. I don't do electronics, obviously. I'm like kind of a jinx here today. I'm sorry. So it's unlikely that we're going to get outcomes if we don't do the innovation as intended, right? If we don't have the core components. Let me give you a quick example. There's something in the world called multidimensional treatment foster care. Has anybody heard of that? Okay, so multidimensional treatment foster care, one of the premises is, you, the very, very difficult usually teenagers, one child to a foster home, intensive training and supports for them. Now, if I don't know fidelity, and I don't maybe don't believe in fidelity, maybe I have five of these homes in my community, and I, thank you. Maybe I say, I have five of these homes in my community, and you know what I think? These kids don't have a lot of supports. Let's get these five boys together in a support group for each other. They're aging out of the system. They need support from one another. No. No, no, no. The developer would throw up. Because a core component is that you are building the kids' pro-social connections, pro-social friends. We are not the worst thing you can do to improve, to make better kids in the delinquency system who are more expert at delinquency, is have them get together. Sounds lovely. You know, it sounds like my mother would have thought that was a good thing. Yes, let's get these children together so they can support each other. But no, you know, that's not fidelity to the model. So we're not going to spend a lot of time on this, but it just shows you that it's no minor thing. I have probably 10 of these slides with 10 different interventions showing you that every time you step off the fidelity cliff, you get worse response. These are 25 therapists. The top half are above fidelity. The bottom half are below fidelity. The control group has a 22% recidivism rate, which is not too bad, really. When you look at the highly competent therapists who are at fidelity, they have a 13% recidivism rate. That's huge. What about the dudes on the bottom who are not operating with fidelity? They do worse than the control group on average. So it's no minor thing to muck around with fidelity. If you're going to muck, measure. I like that. If you're going to muck, measure. Okay. So what else do we know? Well, people say, oh, but if you do this fidelity measurement and feedback and all this coaching and observation, people are not going to like it and they're going to quit and you got all this turnover and turnover is expensive. Actually, no. That was Greg Aaron's hypothesis when he did this study. So these are the percent of clinicians who were retained after 36 months in the field, 58% retention when you have fidelity measurement and a lot of feedback from coaches. 22% less, worse than treatment as usual, when you don't provide them with fidelity and coaching, TAUs, treatment as usual. So again, important ways to do this work. Coaching and training, important work. What do the data tell us? A meta-analysis by Joyce and Showers, borne out by individual studies of training and coaching. No matter how well you do the training, you only get about 5% uptake in the classroom, 5% of teachers who are actually end up even trying it in the classroom, even with very good training. When you add observational coaching of some kind in the classroom, you get a 95% of participants. So when you have to cut something, often people cut coaching. That's probably not a good plan. So, what about this infrastructure? One, the only point I'm going to make here, because I'm going to run out of time, is that pay attention to the functions in those drivers. So that's why it says training, coaching, fidelity assessing, because we're not talking about trainers and coaches. We're talking about who is performing those functions. Can be multiple functions, can go inside one person, you're repurposing existing people. Otherwise people are like, oh, I can't afford all those people. You got those people. You gotta reallocate, repurpose, retrain, which is a big deal in itself. Use data about the quality of the infrastructure. You know, is our training working? Is anybody learning anything? How do we know? Is coaching being delivered as intended? What's our coaching service delivery plan? Are we actually providing coaching with fidelity to that plan? Are people achieving fidelity? Keep the drivers integrated. That just means so often those get into silos. You know, I'm the director of training and I go off and train and I get off the rails. So my favorite story from a long time ago when I was working for a large agency that will remain nameless. I go into watch the trainer do work, and the trainer's doing something that might be based on explicit instruction, but I'm not sure. So there are components to an interaction called a teaching interaction. Initial praise and empathy, describe the inappropriate behavior, give a reason to the kid, describe the appropriate behavior, deliver, blah, blah, blah. So it's like nine components. I go in, and the room is chanting as fast as they can. Initial praise and empathy, description of appropriate, description of appropriate, description of appropriate. Great, you got 20 of those in a minute. I said, Mark, come here. How long have you spent on this? Half an hour. Look how good they're doing. I said, Mark, tell me when those teaching parents in the group home are going to engage in the behavior they've just been practicing. When are they going to stand there and chant these components in the group home? Because if they do, they're certifiable. We need to get them out. Oh, I said, you wasted a half an hour of training time where they could have been practicing with a pretend kid about how to introduce the motivation system, about how to deliver effective praise. Instead, they chanted. So that's what happens when you, if you get these silos going, or somebody said, oh, you know, I just read about, you know, I seem to be on the eight ball, you know, magic eight ball counseling, and we're going to try that. So these things got to be integrated. They got to build on each other. What are we selecting for? What are we training for? What are we coaching for? All leading to fidelity. Implementation teams. This is so important. We can't do this one at a time, a hero alone. We have to have a team of people. Somebody on that team needs to know the intervention or practice or have access to that. They all need to know about implementation. You have some idea about changing the organization because teams tolerate turnover. Near as I can tell, the Arizona Cardinals, for better or worse, will show up every year. That team, no matter if they've changed out players, they're going to show up. Is that the Arizona Cardinals? Is that right? Okay. I'm not big on sports. So we want the teams to stay engaged, stay working, stay educated. So we have to create and sustain them. We have to make space for them to work. If they're working, if they're linked, if you've got, say, school-based teams, they have to have a link into district administration. If you have multiple districts, they got to have a link sometimes into a regional structure or the state structure. You can put this in your own organizational brain. And then, I know it's a no-brainer, but teams need to know why do they exist? What are they there to do? And how do they interact with each other? They need to engage in stage-based work, do the right work for the right stage. They're the ones that are building that driver's triangle. That driver's triangle is the infrastructure. They're charged with building that infrastructure. And they're charged with collecting, analyzing, reporting, and using data to improve the functioning of the team. So we now have a series of capacity assessments to tell you your ability, your capacity to use implementation science well. Those of you in education, the district capacity assessment, you can go on our website and qualify, and it's free to use. All right, so what about this thing called enabling context? So we got to get started, and we got to get better. Here's a sobering observation. All organizations and systems are designed, intentionally or unwittingly, to achieve precisely the results they get. Whatever results you're getting, that's how your system's designed to produce those. That was a sobering intervention for me. And it is our friend, the status quo. I really have a hard time even using the word Trump now, but it was Patrick's quote, so I had to use it. So systems trump programs. So we're trying to insert this thing, to lift this weight into a way of work that can have so many barriers to actually getting the work done. And that's where fidelity starts flying apart, right? Oh, we need minimum of 120 minutes of reading instruction. Well, you know, we can't do that because the music teacher's going to be upset and this person's going to be upset, and so we're going to do 20 minutes. And we're using evidence-based reading approaches. But the environment is not supporting the innovation and the selection of the innovation. And what happens as a result is that those effective innovations are changed to try to survive in the existing system. The pressure on them to change and become ineffective often is tremendous. And sometimes we do it without even thinking, because what are we designed to do as human beings? Don't say reproduce.
Adapt.
Well, adapt. And one of the ways we adapt, we're designed to do, is we're designed to avoid pain, right? Experiential avoidance. I will go to great lengths to avoid pain. When you see kids that have shaped up their appearance to produce temper tantrums for the child, it's like, you know, just eat the lifesaver, shut up. You know, negative reinforcement, for those that are behaviorally oriented, is very powerful. And so what we do, whether we're aware of it or not, when we start changing the program to fit the existing system, because it's so hard to change that system without teams, without implementation science, without a clear definition of what it is, without thinking in stages, is that we go along to get along and change the components that are hard to implement on Apollo 13. So what we want is we want effective innovations. We want the existing system to change to support the effectiveness of the innovation. Well, how do we do that? Well, one of the things that we help people do are to develop transparent linking communication protocols. What does that look like when it's in operation? I had to have my granddaughter help me with the animation. Watch this. Isn't that cool? Anyway, thank you, Jessica. So what does this mean? This means that our policymakers are not out to do harm. Our administrators are not out to do harm. The people who write RFAs are not out to do harm. They really are trying to create a set of conditions that would allow us to improve. They got a plan for us. That plan comes out via policy guidelines, funding systems. And the arrow down says that policy enable practices. PEP. Now, what they don't do is they don't get feedback from the practice arena in a timely way so that practice informs policy. And they know what the consequences of their policy are. As a matter of fact, in my humble opinion, and it's an anomaly for my usually positive self, is I think bureaucracies are often designed to prevent people from getting the bad news. And when somebody dares to bring the news, they're severely punished for bringing the news, because that obviously means you didn't do your job. Don't bring me these problems. I wrote the policy. I got you the darn money. Go out there. What do you mean there's problems? So to get this feedback loop going so that policy that gets developed and redeveloped, or I use that term loosely, guidelines, guiding documents, whatever they are, that there are structures and procedures that actually help the practice get there and get off the ground. So we thought, looked at the literature, thought about it, we thought, you know, let's develop these linking communication protocols. Let's make transparent how one gets feedback and how the conditions under which feedback comes back to the practice level, goes back up. Looked like a straightforward technical fix to me. And then my friend Eric Kloos in Minnesota says, Karen, you don't understand. You're messing with the power base. I said, what? I said, yeah, you know, we get things done because, many of us, because I had a special relationship with this lady here, I do. And so I can kind of get around some things because I know her and she'll give me some wiggle room and I can get some things done. And that gives me an edge up on some other people who don't have that special relationship. Well, now guess what? All y'all are special, all together, all at the same time, and we're gonna look at our collective learning, We're going to raise the right things to that level that are systemic challenges and ask for change and support. And that's messing with the power base. This is one of the hardest things. This has taken me, when I helped state departments of ed get this in place, it's taken me about 3.5 years to get the foundation work under it and get people trusting and get comfortable and feel like they're not going to get punished and hurt and waylaid in the process. So this is not an easy thing. But I always like Jacopo Varela. If you wish to make an improved product, you must already be engaged in making an inferior one. Right? You got to start somewhere. Get started, get better, and be okay with that. So that means we need to build the capacity to use transformation zones, which just means you take a small slice of the system. Don't do statewide stuff is a loser. It's a loser. Especially when you're going to like, we're going to train everybody in the state to blah, blah, blah. No, by the time you've finished training everybody in the state, you've had 30% turnover. People in the first group have forgotten what the heck you told them to do in the first. It's just a loser. I'm sorry for those of you that are engaged in statewide efforts. So, but what you can do is you can take a representative slice of the system from the classroom to the Capitol, from the rehab center to the legislature. There is representative of the system. You can take a few rural areas, a couple suburban areas, a couple urban areas, and you pay attention as you implement that and see what's needed to implement well with the idea, with the promise, that this is our new way of work. We need to learn before we do the next cohort. So make a small mess. Get people who are interested in making a mess with you. Have a representative group. And go again. Again, a hard thing to do. There are some things and some laws that don't allow us to. It's like those of you that are involved with Medicaid funding or CMS, you got to do stuff statewide unless you can get waivers. Anyway, too many weeds, back up on the balcony. That's my cue to myself. Now, too many weeds, back up on the balcony. So using transformation zones to change, creating and using these feedback loops that I just talked about, we want to engage in trial and learning, not trial and error. When we don't use plan, do, study, act, we're doing trial and error, not trial and learning. Increasingly develop a more hospitable environment and reduce barriers and improve resources. And we want to provide feedback to linked implementation teams who are doing the work. So, let's go out on a limb. Let's say that using implementation best practices matters. Let's say that we need all three parts of this formula to actually put things in place. Let's say the hard truth, individual practitioners are not going to get this done on their own. It's a system. When practitioners, educators, physical therapists don't meet fidelity, it's not their problem. Fidelity is a systems diagnostic. It tells you our selection criteria aren't right, our training isn't good enough, our coaching system is too weak, our data systems are not functional. It points out the systemic change you need to support practitioners. And we want to do this with effective implementation methods. Y'all can get introduced to the Active Implementation Hub. There's a wealth of information for you. And we want to increasingly improve the environment so that we get socially significant outcomes for kids and individuals and families. I like Bucky. You never change things by fighting the existing reality. To change something, build a new model that makes the existing model obsolete. Now, he was dealing with an atom-based thing, a geodesic dome, and he still had a hard time getting that to catch on. But the idea is we got to think outside the current box of, if we pick an evidence-based program, all will be well. We need to do that. We need to line up our putts, or it won't go in the hole, for those of you that are golfers. But we're not going to get there by just choosing well, right? So we'll invite you to, we have a free active implementation hub for your team. It has learning progressions. It has videos, it has modules and lessons, and your knowledge acquisition can be done there. And then in the website, there are the references that I used. And if you want more information, you can call us. All this content is licensed under Creative Commons. That means you're free to use it as is with appropriate attribution. If you do adaptations or changes, send it to us quick like a bunny. We'll get back to you quick like a bunny just to make sure there's reasonable fidelity to what we intended and good feedback for us. I love getting it because I'm always going like, gang, we're not teaching this very well because this person sent me this adaptation. So anyway, it's non-commercial use. So you can't sell this and sell your services using our work. So that's it. And we have time for 10 minutes of questions. Questions, comments, rotten tomatoes, ripe peaches. Yes.
So I think what you're saying and what you're projecting on really hits on a lot of what we struggle with as state or government employees.
Right.
My question to you is, as we all know, government systems tend to move very slowly. So what do you advise or recommend so that bits and pieces are not lost as we make changes in a government system that requires you to move at a snail's pace?
Really good question. The question was, given how slow governments move, you know, what can we do to do things in a way that's going to support effectiveness and sustainability? I'm paraphrasing. Am I doing okay? What recommendations do we have? Well, first of all, you're brilliant because you do recognize that governments, they either move at a snail's pace or lightning strikes. You know, one or two things happen, right? Like, oh, okay, there's a crisis and now we got to do some stupid compliance thing that's supposed to fix something that, of course, it won't. So I think for us, a recommendation is some focus. You know, for state departments, we ask them, pick a couple of things that are really important to you and let us help you focus on doing those well. Now, the good news is that much funding for state departments is federal flow-through dollars or you have the ability to contract for. So when I worked with the state, they dramatically rewrote their contracting guidelines for intermediate school districts, ESDs, ISDs, service co-ops, I don't know what you call them, or even if you have them in Arizona, you don't have them. So people that are gonna do work for you, you can write the RFA in an implementation-informed way. You can give them time and space to do the exploration. You can say, so when we worked with the federal level with the Administration for Children and Families for an initiative, they said, the first year is a planning year. Here are the things you need to do that are implementation informed. You need to write an implementation plan at the end of the first year, and not all of you will be funded because we're going to assess your ability to implement. And as a taxpayer, I really appreciate that. So getting people to focus, getting them to pick an initiative to practice on, because it won't go well, and doing the transformation zone approach where you say, okay, we're gonna take this rural area, this frontier area, this suburban area, and this urban area, and we're gonna pull a council together to really work on this and work the bugs out, can be very helpful. It does take time. It's still having some infrastructure in place where some folks that are knowledgeable are gonna be around for 2 to 6 years and are gonna stay on it. Our role as external consultants has been very important. When I said, well, what do you want me to do? You're pretty mature, you're working pretty well. You just said, you need to keep being a critical friend and keep, we talk about gentle pressure relentlessly applied. So, you know, they go like, oh, she's coming back again. She's gonna ask where that second position is. My God, by the next time she, because I always put it on myself. Okay, so obviously I'm not being really helpful. I've come back 4 times. We still don't have this position. What can I do? What are the next right steps? But if I think it's important, I will hound you to death. So what are we designed to do as human beings? Avoid pain. It's gonna be moderately painful when Karen comes back next time. because she's going to ask us again, and I feel embarrassed. So these are kind of silly things, but on the other hand, it is persistence, it's resources, and then there'll be tsunamis and hurricanes and changes in administration and things that happen that, but we have survived some leadership transitions from one party to another party because we planned for it. We had a leadership transition plan in case it was going to transition. We knew what we were going to do to try to prevent that from happening. So I don't have any really magic answers. Sometimes I'm glad when government moves really slowly, like, please, don't do any more damage. But I think in other states, it's been finding quick ways to educate staffers about implementation science and what's required. I mean, they're the ones who are writing the guidelines, the policies, the papers. Pick your influence people. Go to people who know how to do politics, know how to do policy, and find out what's important to them and how to couch the rationales for this for them to meet their goals. So in one state, the governor came in with a new 7-point plan. They always got to have a 7-point plan. It you know, it's really like a 7 big ideas. There's no plan. It's 7 big ideas. And so, because this is universally applicable, you say, I can help you with your 7-point plan. Let me help you implement this. I don't know. Other people probably have good advice for you. Sorry. It's the best I can do. Other questions or comments about how this relates or doesn't relate to your life? I love the parts where people go, Karen, I think you're just total full of it on this part. I don't agree with that. I'm good with that, because that's how I learn. Not that part, but anything. Yes?
Can you help with clarifying that feedback? So at what stage is that? I know it's within full implementation, but...
Well, you start at the beginning. When you're doing exploration and you're getting a team together, you're saying, let's see, what degree do we need to have the system represented on that team? Or if it's going to be a larger initiative, how does this team report a level up? And how do we make that happen? And what does a linked communication protocol look like? So we do two things when we're developing teams. First, we develop something called a terms of reference, which is a internal memorandum of understanding for the team, that the team works out, why are we here, what's our mission, what are we here not to do, what are our resources, what are our deliverables, who do we communicate with? And you would be surprised the number of arguments that go on, because a number of people thought they were there for some other things. But the good news is you're fighting it out, in, if you will, in the abstract, rather than running into it. And when you come up against problems as a team, you're challenging this piece of paper you wrote together, not each other. So that's important to say, well, who do we think we feed information up to, and are they ready to receive it? Because there's some readiness there. You can't say, oh, I have some feedback for you. And like all feedback systems, you need a lot of positive feedback, right? Kids, we say, need at least 4-to-1 ratio. I think adults need about a 10-to-1 ratio, a little more fragile. So you lay it out. Okay, this team is going to feed information up a level on this schedule about these issues. This team agrees to receive these issues and agrees to get back to the other team within X amount of time, if only to say, dang, I don't know, let's work on it. Or, okay, we gotta go up yet one more level, we'll get back to you. But it is ensuring that the loop is working, because if you're just feeding it into a black hole, people will quit giving feedback. Yes?
So that happens throughout?
Yes, and it's also really good if you can do at least one bypass event. What I mean by a bypass event. One event where the highest level in the system is receiving feedback and information from the direct practice level. I call it getting rid of the bullshit filter. So what is really happening? And that can be formal or informal. I mean, I know superintendents that have feedback Fridays. So doors open, come in, all good. Are we done? I think we're done. I'll be around till noon tomorrow.